That's all I have, Your Honor. You're excused. Thank you. Call your next witness. The government would like to call William Marshall, Bill Marshall, to the stand. Please raise your right hand to take the oath. William Marshall, having been duly sworn, was examined and testified as follows. If you will have a seat, please, and state your full name for the record and spell your last name also. William Marshall. Mr. Marshall, where are you living today? As far as I'm in Williamsburg, South Carolina. Why are you wearing an orange jumpsuit? Because I've been found guilty. So you're in jail? This is correct. What are the charges that put you in jail? Well, the charges was for conspiracy for 5 or more kilos and money laundering. 5 or more kilos of what? Of cocaine. And you said a second charge. What's the second charge? That was money laundering and bank and wire fraud. And the bank and wire fraud, what was that related to? Well, the bank and wire fraud was relating to obtaining Highline cars and also homes and various items like such. Was that for a business you called Exquisite Empire? This is correct. Mr. Marshall, I've just handed you a stack of exhibits there. Let's start with the first one. I believe it is either Exhibit 27 or 28. Correct. Now, you said you pled guilty to these charges. In Exhibit number 28, can you tell us what that is? It's the plea agreement. Let me grab those back from you and show those to Mr. O'Brien. Now, sir, Exhibit 28, tell us again what that is? Plea agreement. In what particular case was that for, do you recall? Yes, this is my case out of Orlando, Florida. Did you actually plead guilty to that? Correct. And that was the conspiracy for drug distribution? Correct. What was your sentence? I was sentenced to 100 months. And as part of that sentence, were you given any consideration that you're aware of? Yes, this is correct. Could you rephrase your question? Certainly. Did you cooperate? Correct, I did. And tell us what the nature of that cooperation has been to this point. Well, just basically giving the overall structure of what I was involved in as far as with the criminal empire regarding BMF and also what my role and involvement was in actually how the whole structure operated. So you testified? Correct. Where have you testified? In Orlando, Florida, also in Tennessee, in Detroit, and also in South Carolina. And in consideration for that, you actually got a reduction in your sentence? Correct. And that's how you got down to the 100 months? Correct. Do you recall what your original, what you were looking at the time originally? I believe 20 years. Now, did you also plead guilty to the Georgia indictment? This is correct. And I'll show you government's exhibit number 27. Do you recognize that exhibit? Yes, this is correct. My Rule 20 transfer. And is it also your plea agreement? Yes. Are you familiar with that agreement? Yes, I am. Does it have your signature there, I believe, towards the back? This one is not signed. Okay. Does that appear to be the same one that you signed whenever you entered your plea? Yes, essentially it is. And government's exhibit number 28, let's go back to that one. That's the Orlando plea agreement? Correct. And is that one signed? It's initialed and signed. Is that your signature? Uh-huh. Is that the agreement you entered into? Correct. Your Honor, we'd offer government's exhibits 27 and 28 into evidence. No objection. They're admitted. Let's see government's exhibit number 27. This is the one that you entered into for the Georgia offense. Is that correct? That's correct. All right, and in paragraph 10 here, it talks about your cooperation. Is that correct? That's correct. What is the one condition of your cooperation? First of all, if it's not a truthful testimony, then no matter what point, whether it was a year from now or a year past then, there's no reward. What was your, obviously you've gotten a reward at this point, you think? What is your expectation about your further cooperation? That is, you know, once again, it's all based on what the judge's decision is going to be, but it has to be honest testimony. And this particular agreement says that you will agree to cooperate truthfully and completely with the government at any time, yes? This is correct. And it's up to the government to determine what form of cooperation they will request from you? This is correct. So every time the government has requested your cooperation, have you done so? This is correct. Mr. Marshall, your name is William Marshall, but have you ever used any other names? Yeah, also use Doc or BI. Okay, what about any fake names or false names that you've used? Yeah, there's Anthony Jordan, Jamal Anderson, or Jamal. There was another name that I got a Tennessee driver's license under. I want you to look at Exhibits 20A and 20B. Do you recognize that? Yes. Did you actually obtain that? This is correct. Is that your picture on there? This is correct. Your Honor, we'd offer government's Exhibit 20A into evidence. That's already in evidence. That's actually already in evidence. Can you tell us for the jury what that is? It's the driver's license that I obtained through the state of Tennessee. Would you look at government's Exhibit number 20B for me? Do you recognize that? Correct. Can you tell us, are you the individual who filled that out? Yes, this is my signature and also the application information I filled out. Now, what name did you use to fill that out? Jamal Washington. Why did you use the name Jamal Washington? It was just a name that I made up at the time of two different people that I knew. So you just picked it out randomly? Correct. How was it that you were able to obtain this license? Well, we actually had a person working inside the Division of Motor Vehicles in a supervisory position that we paid under the table to get them. And this is in Tennessee? Correct, Nashville. Why would you get a license with a fake name on it? Well, because the activity that we were conducting at that time, you know, you needed to be able to have a separate identity in case you got caught doing something. Why would you need this separate identity? Like, for example, if you're driving drugs up and down the highway and you get pulled over, you want to be able to separate that from your real person in the event that you're able to possibly could get away. Or if you're trying to obtain or purchase different things that you don't want to have your official government information. You want to separate the two because you can always discard it at any time and go back and get another one. So you protect your real identity and then you have this fake identity to do whatever illegal? Yes. Now, government's exhibit number 20B. Take a look back at that. That's the one that you signed? Correct. And how was that? Was that the application you filled out for the license? This is correct. Your Honor, we would offer 20B into evidence. No objection. It's admitted. So this is your signature right here? This is correct. But you didn't sign your real name? This is correct. And you obtained this on March of 04? I can't read the actual date there. I think it's the 11th of 04 or the 9th. Now, this address here, is that your address? No. Where did you get that address? Well, on our way to the Tennessee DMV, we were riding down the street, so we took it off one of those houses. So you'd literally drive down the street and look up an address? Yeah, because no mail or anything was going to go there. It was just for computer purposes. All right, what about the social security number? Is that your social security number? No. Where did you get that? The social security number was also fictitious as well. How did you come up with that number? Just based off of a formal social security number, the first three being the state and the second two being the generation of birth and the last three being the gender. So is that how they come up with a social security number regularly, or is it just your method for doing it? Yeah, that's the method we used. What about the birth date? Is that your date of birth? No. Where did you get that? That also was invented as well. Now, are you inventing this stuff, or is there somebody that's coming up with this information? Well, no, it basically started from me. So you're doing all this for what reason? What's the main reason behind getting a state driver's license? It's so actually you can turn around and do some legitimate things in an illegitimate organization. What was your business? Well, just obtaining houses, cars, the identifications as you see, and any other financial things that went along with that, along with the distribution of drugs. And that was your business in Exquisite Empire? Exquisite Empire was just cars by themselves, and also purchasing high-line homes, you know, for individuals who actually didn't have the means to go ahead and purchase those things, you know, through legal means. What were the type of cars that you were getting? BMW 745s, Mercedes-Benz, Porsche Cayenne, trucks, on the average between $50,000 and $110,000. That was the value of the cars? Correct. How was it that you were able to obtain these cars? Well, what we did at the time, we used individuals who had credit who could actually purchase it. They had the credit scores and they had the amount of trade line that the bank would approve. Then we would take the money from the buyers who were actually going to be driving these vehicles, and we would put together false employment for them that would substantiate how much they had been making per year. So those forms together, we would get the loans. You would get the loans for vehicles? Correct. Who was making the payments on those loans? Well, it would be the individual who actually was driving the vehicle, as opposed to the individual whose name the car was in? Yes. Now, did you stay in just the car business and house business? No. Did you get into another business? Correct. What kind? Distribution of cocaine. When you say distribution of cocaine, what kind of quantities are we talking about? We're taking 20 to 30 kilos a month. And you say cocaine, what form was the cocaine in? Kilos.